The Cascadia subduction zone is a plate tectonic boundary. So the Earth has tectonic plates that are moving in different ways. Ours happens to be coming together. So we are riding on the North American plate. The Juan de Fuca plate is offshore, and the Juan de Fuca plate is being pushed underneath the North American plate. Those plates are getting pushed together and building pressure. And when they break, that's when we have a subduction zone earthquake. The reason they're so large is because a big area of coastal crust breaks in that pressure release. Based on our experience in Japan and Chile, they felt these earthquakes hundreds of miles away. So we will experience significant shaking in Portland due to the break off the coast. The really big difference between these earthquakes and other earthquakes you might have felt are the fact that it's going to be going for 3 to 6 minutes. And based on how the fault breaks, you'll get strong shaking at a bunch of different times within that zone. The longer duration really does affect especially taller structures and long span bridges. The more shaking happens, the more ability that they have to sway further. You're gonna get bigger movements within those structures due to the duration of the shaking. Scientists in Oregon and Washington have been studying our subduction zone for several decades now, and we have one of the best documented subduction zones on the planet. Based on the records that they've got, we've had 41 earthquakes over the last 10,000 years, over magnitude 8. They, on average, happen every 300 to 350 years. And we know that our last one happened in January 1700, so we are 317 years into that cycle, which means we're expecting an earthquake any day. Down in Portland, we expect large areas of liquefaction all along the river. And in other areas where water or humans have deposited loose sandy soils. Liquefaction is what happens when you have loose, sandy, saturated soils, usually near water bodies, that are subjected to shaking, and what we have is an earthquake. So when the earthquake happens, it shakes, causes the soils to lose their strength and the water to bubble to the surface, and you get a quicksand-like example. It's a lot like when you go to the beach down by the shore and you shake and have the water bubble up and your feet sink. That's liquefaction. Any structure that wasn't built on deeper foundations that go through the liquefiable soils will be affected by settlement as well as lateral spread. So the soils will liquefy and move towards the river. It can significantly damage all foundations, bridges, anything that is relying on that soil to be where it's supposed to be. Most of our bridges in downtown Portland were built before we knew about the earthquake hazard here in Oregon. So we don't anticipate that any of them will be usable immediately after the earthquake. Yep. Most of them will be severely damaged, if not collapsed. If you can imagine your commute through Portland, looking right here, we can see that the Burnside Bridge, even in the middle of the day, is heavily used. We use our bridges all the time. A east-west crossing across the Willamette River is imperative for Portland, not only in emergency response, but also long-term recovery. What I took away from my trip to Japan was the ability of engineers to understand what natural hazards are and design to withstand them. It made me really think that we can do this, and it's something that we can, as a society, can prepare for. And if we look to retrofitting and replacing our infrastructure in the most intelligent ways, we can come back after a 9.0 earthquake.
Multnomah County is investing in the future. A feasibility study is underway to help make the Burnside Bridge earthquake ready. We can't do this without you. Please join the conversation and learn more at burnsidebridge.org.